Welcome to our special Google Hangout on Air. I'm Sunny Galt with New Mommy Media, and we create audio podcasts for new and expecting parents. And we love to do these Google Hangouts where we can interact with you and some great experts that we've had on these Hangouts. We are partnering with the San Diego Parent Connection as well as Scripps Health for this important topic today. We're talking about dealing with the quote unquote terrible twos, and we're going to have some tips on how to make those terrible twos more terrific. So joining us now is Noni Levi. And Noni, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself? I know you've been on these hangouts with us in the past, but for the people watching that haven't met you before, what do you do? Tell us about yourself.
I'm a licensed marriage and family therapist who's been in private practice so for probably 20 years. I have been a parent educator with the Parent Connection when it was actually Las Madres and then the Parent Connection for 23 years.
All right. Well, let's talk a little bit first about the age that we are talking about. We say terrible twos. I've even heard some parents refer to it as the terrible threes. So apparently it can continue past. I know my own personal experience. I have four kids of my own. And my first child, I felt started to go through this kind of rebellious, I want to do things on my own period, even at 18 months. So what age range are we really talking about here?
That was great that you brought that up, Sunny, because most people think it starts at 2 and ends at 3. It can start as early as 15 months and can go up until age 5. So the span really is dependent on each child based on their temperament and kind of who they are. Like you were saying with your child, my son didn't even, I went through the twos and I thought, oh, I'm such a good parent educator. I didn't even have any problems. And then he hit 3 and it was exactly going through that quote unquote terrible twos. So he didn't start till about 3. So it's different for every child.
Okay. And then what's happening within the child? Can you give us a glimpse? Because we get so frustrated as parents and we don't realize this can be developmental. So what's happening there?
Well, it is developmental. And one of the first things that a parent needs to realize is the child is no longer the center of your universe. When you think about, having your infant to your baby, you can almost anticipate, by based on their cries, based on what time it is, kind of what their needs are. And many times as parents, we're almost meeting our baby's needs before would they even ask us. So now we have a toddler, and a toddler is being asked to walk instead of be carried, asked to use their words instead of just grunts and moans. And so they're being asked to do some things that they kind of resist a little bit. It's like we all like to be a little babied. So part of it is they're being asked to do more things that they haven't done before. And also, it is a natural developmental stage to pull away from the parent. There's actually three different stages for that. And that would be around that 2 time. And again, we said that could start earlier and go a little later. It also at age 6, which a lot of parents don't know. And then the teenage years. These are the typical developmental times when a child is pulling away. But when you think about, and what a lot of times toddlers will do, they'll kind of run away from you. And what parents will notice is they'll start to run away, but they will turn around to see if you're there. So it's kind of like their first pull on the rope, like, I want to be away from you. And then, like, oh my gosh, I am away from you. And they'll run right back to you. So they're testing that, they're testing themselves. They also are, so that rope goes out a little further, and then they get scared and they back up from it. So that's one of the things that's going. So they're no longer the center of the universe. They want to be independent, but they want to be far away, but not too far away. So you'll hear a lot of things like, you do it, if you ask them something, and then they'll say, no, me do it. And they'll go back and forth with that. They're not really sure about that. Their needs for safety and security, they need to know that the parent's there for their safety and their security. Two of the favorite words at this age are me and mine. They're starting to develop their starting of social skills. So parents always kind of what I notice, they always get very upset when their toddler isn't showing good manners in the sandbox. And this is just the start of this. And so they're having to learn kind of, this is mine. And you might have some toddlers that are more the grabby ones, and some the more that immediately give up their toys and they start crying. And then you kind of set up a scenario between, like, oh, this one's the bully, this one's the victim, because there's one child that might be more assertive at that age than another child. And you want to kind of stay out of that. Identifying one as a bully or one as a the victim. So you want to teach a child who tends to be more passive, give them a voice, so say no loudly, and to be able to assert themselves. And for a child who's naturally more assertive, you want to teach them to kind of, ask for their turn. So this is going to be like a long process. If they start at about 15 months until about five, you know, part of a big part of parenting at this time is to helping them learn social skills. So they're not going to have it right away. In fact, I think some parents will say, you know, you need to share. And I think that actually cognitively can't even happen until after age four. Their other favorite word, which I guess would be no, and part of the reason that no is such a big word for toddlers is one, it's very easy, and two, they've been told no a lot. Touch that, no, don't do this, no, don't do that. So they get that this is a powerful word. Another important thing, and some parents have a very easy time with this, and some it's very difficult based on their kind of personality, but they love order, sameness, and routines. So it's really important at this age. In fact, you can create more frustration for toddlers when there is not a set routine. The more you get a routine set, the more easier it's going to go, because one of the big things that parents really need to start doing with children of this age, and I'll get into it in just a bit, I don't want to jump ahead, but is setting boundaries. And boundaries create order, sameness, and routine. The other thing to note developmentally is emotions can be very quick changing, intense, come on very quickly. This is why we talk about the temper tantrums. I remember I was taking care of my nephew, and he was, you know, I think around two at the time. And we were blowing bubbles out in the courtyard, and he loved blowing bubbles. And I said, okay, now it's time, we're going to put the bubbles away. And he threw himself onto the concrete, and I thought he was going to go into a full-on temper tantrum. He started to cry, and all of a sudden our cat walked by, and he went, kitty cat, and just completely changed. So it's like, you know, it's like you're on this whirlwind, and then just in a second longer, a whole new emotion. So, and this is why temper tantrums can be overwhelming for parents at this age. So that's about it on a general sense of what developmentally is going on for kids, is they're trying to, you know, be a little independent, but it's a little scary. You know, there's going to be learning their own emotions. They're also, again, trying to get routines. They're learning social skills, as well as for the parents. It's a very overwhelming time for both.
Oh, Noni, you are totally speaking my language right now, because I have twins that are 2.5 that are doing everything you're talking about.
And going two different directions.
They are. Everything that you just said, I was like, check, times two. Yeah. So yeah, totally a challenge. Let's talk a little bit about what parents can do. And honestly, this is therapy for me too. Just getting out of the house this morning, we had temper tantrums galore and a lot of no's and crying and stuff like this. So let's talk about what parents can do here. And I know we talked about at least one of these before, but let's start with firm and kind parenting. What do you mean by that?
Okay. So most of us come into the parenting, you know, when we become a parent, we usually sit on a spectrum, and everything, I like to look at everything as a spectrum. So on the very far end on one side, say to the left of us, would be a more permissive parent. And to the very far right, you would have a very autocratic, firm parent. And so the example I always like to use is for the very firm parent, sometimes it can go to the extent of where corporal punishment is used a lot. It's I'm in control. You're going to listen to me, you know, and it can go anywhere on that spectrum. And for the permissive parent, I always like to use the example, it was the last place I wanted my son to be as a teenager. And these are the kind of parents that say, well, they're going to drink, they might as well do it here. They're going to smoke pot, might as well do it in my home. So that kind of gives you a sense of the far end. So what you want to do is you kind of want to bring it all in, and you want to be in the middle. And most parents sit on one side or the other naturally. If you are a more permissive parent, this is going to be a hard time for you, because really it's important to learn boundary setting. There are some wonderful books that you can get. One of the authors I always like to refer to, it's a very easy book, quick read, and I know there's not much time as a parent with small children, her name is Anne Catherine, last name spelled like the woman's name with a K, Catherine. And she wrote a book called Boundaries. And one is, you know, where to draw the line, and the other one is where do I stop and you begin. There was two that she wrote. If you grew up in a more autocratic home, what I like to do, and I'll take my glasses off for this, I am a naturally more autocratic parent. That was, you know, boundaries were easy for me. Kids would come into our home that were not my own, and they knew when Noni said this, Noni meant this, and they pretty much would follow suit. But what I had to learn, I call it my either Stepford wife face or my Viking and after section face. And you just kind of smile. It's like, you know, I would say to myself, okay, I want to kill them right now, but I'm just going to act like it's not bothering me. So this is an important element, because when you go to set a boundary, if you set it with a like a face that I would normally have, like, what are you doing? And, you know, you're tight and you're uptight. Kids get you're in a power struggle. But if you say, do you want to give mommy the pencil or do you want to take the pencil with a happy face? That is an exact firm behind moment. You're setting a limit, but you're doing it with a more lighter affect, and you're not so stressed. So it's, I feel one of the most important skills you can do is to work at becoming firm and kind at the same time. One of the quotes I always like to use is that children over the age of 3 who continue to test boundaries have been trained to do so by their parents. So it's very important to get good at boundary setting. It's important for your toddlers and it's important for yourself.
Okay. And the next one is to offer appropriate choices.
Correct. Now, this is where I see a lot of parents make mistakes. Permissive parents will many times, if they think if they keep asking nice enough, the child will finally comply. So for instance, Jimmy, could you get in your car seat? Jimmy, can you get in your car seat? Jimmy, can you get in your car seat? And then finally what happens with parents, even the permissive parents, Jimmy, get in your car seat! And then what happens for parents is they start feeling guilty. Oh my gosh, I yelled at him, I swore I wasn't going to yell like my mother, or I smacked him on their tushy and I swore I wasn't going to hit him like my dad hit me. So there's like this up and down. That's why it's really important to be firm and kind at the same time. So when you give a choice, you only give it once. So it would be, Jimmy, do you want to get in the car seat or do you want mom to help you? At the point that he doesn't get in the car seat, you move yourself forward. Because by moving yourself forward towards that child, you're telling them, I'm going to attend to this. So when I did this with my own son, which is usually around 18 months that they don't really cooperate and get in that car seat. I said that, Jimmy, do you want to get in the car seat? Notice my face is light. I'm doing firm and kind. I'm not saying, Jimmy, do you want to get in the car seat or you want mom to get you in there? That would create a power struggle. So Jimmy, do you want to get in your car seat or do you want mom to help you? And as soon as he didn't comply, then I said, I guess you're choosing for me to choose. I had to do that 3 times. And when I did choose to then put him in, I was sweating profusely, holding him down while I locked him in his car seat. But on the 4th one, when I said, Jimmy, do you want to get in your car seat or do you want mama to do it? And he didn't comply. And I started moving towards him. All of a sudden he goes, me do it. And he hopped right in. Now, you may have a temperamentally more challenging child who's more persistent. They may test you longer on that, but I guarantee if you stick with it, even a more persistent power kid will start to comply. In fact, that's the one thing when parents have, and I think you did a talk earlier on spirited child. So persistence is one of the most difficult temperament traits to deal with. And I used to tell parents when they came to my support group that the hardest thing to do with a persistent child is to set a boundary. And the thing you must do is set a limit, because they will constantly start walking over it and have no respect for any authority. So it's real important to set boundaries with them. So you, any choices you give, you only give it once. And then the next choice out of your mouth is an action you can take. Do you want, and then you also want to give concrete choices, especially at this age. So do you want to, if there's power struggles over them getting dressed, do you want to put on your pants first or your top first? Do you want to wear your red pants or your green pants? If it's brushing your teeth, do you want to brush with this toothbrush or that toothbrush? Do you want mommy to brush first or do you want to brush? I have been told that toddlers usually choose, I think, the second choice. So do you want mommy to carry you or do you want daddy to carry you? Might be an effective choice if mommy doesn't want to carry the toddler. So it's always, you know, it's never like, what do you want to wear today? You know, what do you want to do? You want to give a choice. And the most important thing with choices is that the parent is okay with the choices. It doesn't matter if the child's happy, but the parent must be okay with the choices.
I love some of the choices, the examples that you gave, because when I think of choices, I think that they have to be very different from one another. Let's use the example that you used of getting dressed in the morning. I have to fight my kids on this constantly, right? And so, you know, for me, I was thinking, oh, I have to give them 2 different choices of outfits. And the example you gave was, no, do you want to put your shirt on first or do you want to put your pants on first? Like, I'm still getting to choose, because Lord knows what they would choose if they could choose their own clothes, right? So I like that it doesn't have to be like a big choice. It can be very subtle, but I think it's about the kids like giving some control, if you will, back to the kids, like making them feel that they're part of the process.
Correct, correct. And, you know, one of the questions we used to always ask in the parenting class, and we, you know, there'd be, you know, 20 to 30 people sitting there, and we'd say, okay, is there anybody in this room who doesn't like to have power? You know, in all my years of teaching, there wasn't one person that said, oh, I don't like any power. You know, children are just smaller human beings. That's all. And you're exactly right, Sunny. Everybody wants to feel like they have some power and control in their life. And when you're a toddler, your parents are doing everything and making all the decisions for you. So if you get to at least choose which kind of pants you want to wear, which dress you want to wear, or which color toothbrush you want to use, those are appropriate.
What happens if you have a child, because this just happened to me this morning, and I feel like my girls are on this spree of doing this, where they have a temper tantrum. And because what I usually do is I kind of let them be. And like you said, and I go about and I do the stuff that I need to do because I know they're not going to hurt themselves. And the attention just aggravates the whole situation. But right. What if it's something where you, like this happened this morning to me, and we had to get everyone in the car because I had to take my kindergartner to school and they needed to go to daycare. And it was one of those things that I couldn't just let it simmer, you know, I had to deal with it. And what I ended up doing is picking her up and, you know, putting in her car seat, and she's kicking and fighting me. And I just don't know what to do at that point, because I can't do what I would normally do if we didn't have to be somewhere right away.
That's why mornings are a very stressful time for most parents. If it is not too big of a temper tantrum, try to think of a way you could empower that child at that moment. So do you want to walk to the car? Do you want to hop to the car like a bunny? And I want to run like a gazelle. So you can shift sometimes if it's just about power and they're feeling disempowered because they're being rushed out the door. Because, you know, the toddler is also, they like to toddle. They like to take their time. And, you know, when we're trying to get out the door and we have a schedule we have to meet, they really aren't even that into it. So trying to do a fun choice. Now, if they're over the top, you really can't do anything. You could do exactly what you did, Sonny. You know, there was one story I read where a father, daughter was having a temper tantrum in Burger King. Everybody was staring at him. He was feeling overwhelmed. He tucked his daughter under his arm. She's kicking, screaming, you know, head spinning, the whole thing. And he walks out. And what he said to himself, and I always love this, he said, I'm having a relationship with those people in Burger King for 3 minutes. I'm having a relationship with my daughter the rest of my life. And one of the things that's very important, most parents parent to get the situation under control. You want to parent for the long term. So, you know, I would have just maybe given her a choice of, you know, you can hop to the car like a bunny, or you can run like a gazelle, or you can walk to the car, or mama can carry you. One of those. And if she still was in the throes of it, I guess you're choosing for mom too. And it will just be one of those mornings that you're going to go out the door sweating. She's going to go out the door sweating. You're all going to be exhausted and you're going to go, whoa, this is not the way I want to do it again. So, but you're going to have those moments when you have toddlers. That's, you know, that's just part of it.
Yeah. That's kind of what it looked like for me this morning. I was just glad that both of my girls, my twins, didn't do it at the same time. I have had those mornings where, you know, I'm kind of like this going out of the house, but thankfully this morning was
That's where you leave one of the puppies inside if you can, and then run out and get the other one in, and then get the other one out. Yeah. It's hard.
Such is our crazy life, right? All right. Well, Noni, thanks so much for being with us today. It's always a pleasure. It's fun chatting with you. If you guys haven't checked out the Parent Connection and you're in the San Diego area, please do so. It's a great resource for parents here. Also, we'd love for you to check out New Mommy Media, and we produce podcasts for new and expecting parents. All of our podcasts are available on our website. We have free apps. We do product reviews. We do a lot of cool stuff. So check it out at newmommymedia.com. If you enjoyed today's hangout, just share it with another parent so we can help them out as well. And we'll see you next time.